As I always said, it's unlicensed by virtue of it not being licensed to the ABA or the British Boxing Board of Control. But I personally feel there's room for it, you know. But my dream would be to see somebody like the British Boxing Board of Control have an arm for novice boxing, you know, where there is novice championship bouts over 5 2-minute rounds, you know what I mean? So it's like a step up from, rather than amateur going straight from amateur to pro, an amateur who goes into novice, then go into pro. Because there's the no head contact thing, they're naturally not going to earn as much as a pro. You know, you still get your... I would like to see a pay scale of £50 to £300 for a title fight. But if it's governed by someone like the British Board of Control, whereby, you know, like how the ABAs have a standard medical, normally that's a brain scan, to have your standard medical, X, Y, and Z. So I think doing it that way, you'd get a different genre of people that are getting into the sport, because you've got a lot of young people from hard areas. They don't want to do amateur boxing, they want to box and earn. But if they can earn 100 quid, 200 quid, you know, every month, then it becomes a more tangible thing for them. Then I think out of that, you'll get fighters that, you know, because with novice boxing, rather than teaching them the amateur tactics, they're learning more the pro game. So when that young person goes through to pro boxing, I reckon out of a British Boxing Board of Control novice arm, you'd get more British boxing champions at pro, because they're learning how to play the pro game, you know what I mean? I said 5-2s, didn't I? But 5-3s, you know, for a championship fight. You know, 3-2 standard. But like I said, going that route, because sometimes you get some amateur boxers, they go into the pro game and they get totally lost. You know what I mean? They can't adapt. If they were able to go into the novice game to help for that adaptation to take place, then they go through. You know what I mean? I would strongly feel there's an out for it, but I don't think that amateur boxing, amateur boxing association could handle something like that. You know what I mean? But it's too. You start handling money and it's a different type of game. You know what I mean? No head guards, nobody pressing buzzers to score points. No, same scoring system as the pro game. Same rules as the pro game. It could be a whole training ground for professional boxing, from the corner people to the referee. You know, you get people that sign up, paid £100 for a referee license. They've got to go on the pro boxing course. So there's room for them, you know, in their preliminary role. We'll go and sort out the novice thing. You know what I mean? So they learn. So you find from that, you might get a referee that looks good on paper, but then, you know, you get another referee who's not that good on paper, but you watch how the referees are fight, he's world class. You know what I mean? Because identify more of that, and they'll be the ones that progress, and the board can see, can progress through to the pro game. You know what I mean? So I think after 5 years, I reckon it'll change the boxing scene. For the amount of, I think we currently have just over 2,000 pros in the country. Not all active, but I reckon the number could, over 5 years, 3,000, 4,000 pros. You know what I mean? Fully signed pros that are going under the BBBC rules through the novice ranks, because it'd be a fantastic way to, as we've got this multicultural thing with Europe, but a lot of lads coming in from the Eastern Bloc, Polish lads, Yugoslavian lads, Czech Republic lads, French lads, get a lot of them into boxing, but a lot of them want to earn, you know. We get lads in here that come in the gym all the time from Poland. Some of them have got a bit of boxing skill. But I know they're not going to be tempted by the amateur boxing game. If I could say, right, there's a novice boxing game, these are the rules, this is how we do it. You've got to have a fitness test, your medical. There's a small license fee, you know what I mean, to take away the unlicensed tagging. You know, let's not have ridiculous money, let's just make it 25 quid. And there's these gyms that you've got set up for the schooling of, you know what I mean, helping a novice with very little, if no boxing experience, teach them how to play the game. Also, amateurs that are good at their game, how to teach them how to play the pro game. You know, because I see a lot of amateur boxers competing. I like what they do with the speed and the zip and all the rest of it, but and sometimes I'm watching them and I'm thinking, if this was 3-3s or 4-3s or 6-3s, you know, with that amount of speed and tenacity and what you're doing, you're going to get annihilated. You know, it only tends to be the bigger names in the amateur boxing game that tends to get through. But if you look at boxing historically, it's not always these bigger ABA names that have come through and become British European or indeed world champions. Sometimes you get some lads that, you know, started boxing really late. Had a few amateur fights, might have had 30 fights, won 16, lost 14. He fights pro. You've only got to look at Steve Robinson's record, that's a prime example. I know a lot of people use Steve Robinson's, you know, story for examples like that, but I think there's a lot to be gained from the novice boxing game, and I'd like them to stem away from this unlicensed thing. I think they really should look at it more in a productive sense, because if a big body like the British Boxing Board or the Amateur Board were to take it under their arm, it will protect more people who are stepping in the ring, taking part in the sport. Because I see it myself. I see people with learning difficulties on these shows taking part in a boxing match, and I'm sat there terrified for the person, thinking, my God, please don't let this kid get hit in the head, because he shouldn't be in there, you know. You see people who are greatly overweight, not in condition at all, and you can tell the boxing experience is 2 months in the gym. Because they're a popular individual, because they're in the pub every weekend and they can sell a lot of tickets, they're getting an opportunity on these shows to express themselves and show the skills. Again, a very dangerous thing to do. So I think if the British Boxing Board were to take something like novice boxing under its arm, it will police it a lot better, so these daft things don't happen. So when the public see these things taking place, then they can say, right, this is unlicensed boxing, this is no good, this, you know what I mean? You do have decent lads on the novice circuit or the unlicensed circuit.
We've had this stigma probably on underground boxing, unlicensed boxing, and all, you know, it's kind of got this air of,
That's it, it gets stigmatised, but you know, it's, but it's all right calling it unlicensed boxing, but as soon as you put on a white collar event, well, what's that?
Exactly.
You know, so really, it's like, there's a social class thing in the world of boxing, it's true. You know, you've got amateur boxing, then you've got what the Scallies do, which is unlicensed boxing. But you know, when us Posh Fair put something together and we want, you know, Jed from The Office to fight, you know, Robert from The Boiler Room, and we're all going to do it for charity, we can then call it white collar, because there's something good about white collar. But you know, there's loads of unlicensed shows that where the promoters put on the event and all the proceeds have gone to charity. You know, because he hasn't called it the white collar thing, you know, he still gets tarnished with that unlicensed lessons. But like I said, there's a lot to be done there as far as the policing of it's concerned. And also inviting different types of people into the game. You know, because there's so many young people out there with issues, you know, they've got problems with crime and their own health and how they're going to get forward in life. A lot of them would love to box, but to actually take on the dedication needed to become a good boxer, you know, it's a bit hard for, you know, so you find some that come and then they'll wean off. I often believe that if there was a more immediate financial goal for what it is that they're doing, then it might be enough to, you know, just to keep them in that bit longer so they can get the skills, test them skills, so they become an athlete to the sport. No, but I think, like I said before, novice boxing is the way to go for that one, not necessarily amateur boxing, only because, dare I say it, in the amateur game, the amount of politics and nonsense that goes on with it, you know, it puts a lot of fighters off, turns a lot of fighters away, you know, because we've lost our way a bit over the years, boxing, with the, you know, the introduction of MMA, you know, different combat sports. But really and truly, nobody can convince me any differently that it's still not the number one combat sport in the world today. You know, my view on boxing is, well, we play a game where there's physical contact, you know, but it's purpose-made physical contact. So it's not necessarily going to be the most attractive thing to most people. But in saying that, you know, there's ball games, you've got football, tennis, cricket. So in our sport, you know, let's not oppose MMA, let's not oppose Thai boxing, let's not oppose any other contact art forms. Let's embrace it, because that's what we do. We do contact sport, you know, whereas these footballers, they play ball games. So if everybody was to work, you know, as one, and the MMA people are talking, you know, stop talking about, oh, our sport is the bigger sport. Boxing folk talking about our sport has got the longest history and is the bigger sport. It's all one thing, it's contact sport. So a contact sport can be used in other areas to help people, you know, get through their life. You know, I find it very, very handy for young offenders or people who think they're Billy Tenman on the street. They're only 16 years old. Get them in a boxing gym or a combat sports gym, you know. The big bad boy on road and his big BM, 25 years of age, flashing it about a bit, always been interested in fighting. Yeah, get him on the bag. That's how you can fight. Then put a 14, 15, 16 year old to watch this person on the bag. The moment you see that and the person can't, and you see the person can't fight, you'll find that person instantly has lost credibility to those young ones. But it's them same young ones is saying, you sell this for me, when he's out on road. So that's the beauty of places like this. But we don't necessarily see the authorities on the people with the purse strings who can help projects like this keep going. They don't necessarily understand it, you know what I mean? You know, if I went to college for 3 years and got a degree and a certificate to say that I studied psychology and X, Y, and Z, and then I did something like this, then that will probably quantify for them to want to fund such a project. That's the bit that doesn't make sense to me. Only because when you're dealing with youngsters, you need practical experience. One, in what you're teaching, and two, in dealing with the youngsters. For me, anybody that's from an area that has levied success or gained success and they set up something like this, there should be certain hoops and boxes that don't need ticking because common sense tells you it's going to work. You know what I mean? If you had a little Johnny there who's robbed 20 shops, punched another kid in the eye, he's been to court 6 times, been convicted on all 6 times as a young offender, he's now 16, he's demonstrated an interest in boxing, or keeping fit with boxing being an interest. Or you've got a trained psychologist at a youth support centre who's ready to engage that young person. Both work will work fantastically well for that individual, but I'm firmly of the belief that the person who's tutoring the boxing and is from the area and who knows the young lad's dad, because his dad used to go to his fights when if I was to present you with that information, common sense tells me that this is the person this young person's going to bond with quickest. Then we bring the psychologist in, because I've broken the barriers. Without having to go through the motions and all the rest of it, it's what I call privileged access. Lots of people that live in different areas around the country where they do have this privileged access within their communities. And for a lot of young people, having access to that individual, if they've got a setup like this, having access to that can prevent a lot of problems further down the line. I've been here now 10 years nearly. No, I've actually got proof of it. I know where I can show evidence of a young person, right, they've got a slight case of mental illness when they're 14, but now they're 16, they're in college, looking for a job, everything at home is all right, blah, 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 but it's only because they got involved here. And they're coming here off their own back, sometimes there'll be a referral, but the bottom line is they're around here dealing with real people, because in the fight game you can't lie, you get found out, and that's the beauty of it. You know, you can be a politician and a liar. You can be a doctor and a liar. Murderer as well. You can be a nurse and a liar. You can't be a professional fighter and be a liar. And I think society needs to recognise that, because there's many, many professional fighters that have served their time and competed, done great with their careers, but now they're back in the communities as older people. But I think that they're amazing resources for local authorities and local communities to tap into, because it can sort a lot of problems out. You know, and if there's a group of young people smashing windows in the local town centre, I'm 100% confident in my locality that all the council needs to do is bring in me and two of my team, not the police, and we'll get rid of the problem, and we'll also give the young people something to do. I'm that confident. But again, it's whether the local authorities or the authorities, the powers that be, can understand something like this, you know. Because I think there's people in the fight game that do deserve to go to universities and be honoured their degree, be honoured their doctorate. You know, I'd love to see Muhammad Ali given a doctorate in boxing. I'd love to see Joe Kawasaki given a doctorate in boxing. You know what I mean? You know, for what they've achieved, they should be able to do that. But the way things go, you know, you can set a year-long course, a six-week course in some cases, and be qualified to teach a combat sport. It doesn't make sense to me. You know, it doesn't make any sense at all. Any questions?